This video intended for educational purposes.
Hey guys, it's Adam AK Swimming Bird, and welcome to the first giant snapshot update of Minecraft version 1.8. This is 14W2B, and as we expected, it is huge. There is a ton of stuff. There are new blocks, new mechanics, a complete overhaul to villager trading, enchanting and adventure mode, a command for locking chests, and tons more. I will go into all the details, but first, I hope you guys don't mind. I've been practicing my survival high dive, and I'm just going to jump right off here, and if we can maybe manage to land on the second diving board, boing, there we go, and just nail the landing. Perfect, all right, so I'll go into what's going on there in a second here. First, I want to show you this other high dive. This is the kiddie one. It's the diving board's slightly shorter, so it's for kids. Let's just jump off here, and guys, there's no water in the kiddie pool. No! Oh, so there we go. Thank you. This is the new slime block for 1.8. It's one of the new blocks, and you probably guessed that by now. It is used for bouncing. You don't take any fall damage when you land on it. So if you don't want to jump into water when you're getting off of your giant high base up in the sky, jump on some slime blocks. As you saw, it propelled me back up into the air a little bit. I will go into just how far you can bounce with this stuff in a second, but first I want to cover some of the other qualities of the slime block here. Let's go over. So this is how she looks. This is the slime block right here, and it is crafted with 9 slime balls, like so. If you want to get these slime balls back for your sticky pistons or potions or whatever you want to do, you can just pop it back in the crafting table and get it back. But this is a nice way to kind of store all of your slime that you've probably built up over the years. This is how it looks when stacked together. They each have their own core. It's a little translucent, kind of like the stained clay. Looks pretty good to me. You guys know that soul sand makes you walk really slow. Well, slime is even worse. Excuse me, sheep. This is super sticky and weird, and it makes you walk really slow. If you put soul sand on top of slime, it takes that quality and makes you go even slower. So if you want to get someone stuck in your base or something, throw that in there. I've got some bunk beds over here, so you can jump off the top bunk and bam, pile drive your sibling. Don't do that. This is one of the things I forgot to illustrate here. You guys probably noticed this. This is my animal bounce house. I've been messing around with this. These animals love the slime block. Let me tell you, they love being leashed up and bouncing up and down. So the lead makes them bounce a little bit already, but when they bounce on the slime, they can get going. The cat is really good at it, so hopefully he'll show off here. So this was also illustrating that the carpet there, you can put it on top of slime blocks and you can still bounce on it. So that's pretty cool, just like the bed. There goes the cat. So other things you can put on top of the slime blocks, you can put the weighted pressure plates, you can put the normal pressure plates, you can put rails of all variety, you can put the redstone, any of this and you'll still be able to bounce. Unfortunately, snow will not go onto a slime block, and the daylight detectors can, but they won't bounce you. Sad. But anyways, there's still a lot of stuff you can put on these guys and bounce around. In terms of how high they will jump and bounce you when you land on them, this is 64, the base block height, and if you want to get max air, that's 58 blocks, you're going to need to travel 700 blocks and fall. So I'm going to do that here. I'm going to teleport up. This also illustrates a weird glitch here. If you're above block height in the snapshot, you completely disappear in F5. I'm going to pop back in as soon as we get below it, and let's watch, see how high we bounce. There we go, a little over the diving board. So should be about 58 blocks. If you go any higher than 700 meters up or 700 blocks, you won't bounce any farther. That is the terminal velocity and like the max height you will go. It's about 60% of how far you fall or so a lot of the time. And then every subsequent bounce kind of cuts it in half until you stop bouncing. If you fall from really high, but you hold the jump button though, you will instantly just do a normal jump and you can jump off of there. So yeah, if you don't want to bounce that high, just hold the jump button. But these mechanics might change in the future, but right now that's still pretty impressive. To be able to jump that high from ground level by bouncing is insane. So it's not all about the slime box, folks, as much as I love them. Let's move on to the other types of blocks, and here they are. These are the stone variants, and I'll give you a good look at these in a sec. They are granite, diorite, and andesite, spelled with an S, said with a Z. If you want to find these, you can find them in any biome out in the world where you could find stone. They spawn in patches, much like gravel or dirt. And you can also craft them, though. So if you want diorite, this is the main one that you're going to need. You need to do cobble and nether quartz in a crisscross little checkerboard pattern. You can flip these over. As long as they're checkerboarded, then you can craft it and you get two diorite from that. Now, if you have diorite, you can make the other two. So one diorite block and one cobblestone gets you two andesite. And one diorite and one nether quartz gets you one granite. So, and these two are formless recipes. You can put those blocks anywhere in there that you want. Now that you have those, though, if you want to put them in a block of four, you can get polished diorite, polished andesite, and polished granite. And that's what those look like. I'm going to compare them to the other blocks here. You can kind of see them up against a bunch of other material. So they're stone variants, but that also means their mining time, the blast resistance, all the other qualities are the same as stone. So they're just very similar little guys there that'll pop up in the world. I'm going to teleport here. I could have flown, but there we go. Take the lazy way. So this is a extreme hills that I generated here near spawn. So we've got andesite here. We got granite. There's some diorite over the bend here. Diorite really stands out. I don't know about that one in terms of like naturally spawning. It kind of looks weird. But the other ones look good. But yeah, that's how you find them. They'll be in any biome. You don't have to go to extreme hills, but you can get them. Or if you don't want to generate new terrain, say you have an old world and it would be hard to find them, at least you can craft them. So I like that. And speaking of crafting, we've got some new crafting recipes, including ones to make blocks that we haven't been able to make before. So first off, you guys know how to craft a door. Six little wooden blocks like that. Or you can use six of any type of wood. Now that we have six types of wood, why not use one of each? You could do that in the past, but I just think it's funny. We have so many types of wood. So if you want to get doors now, you will get three when you craft them. Same with iron doors. You get three doors, so it's a lot easier to build some doors. And also, you can stack them in stacks of up to 64 like most other things in the game. So finally, doors aren't hogging all the space in the inventory. So some other things we can craft now, the mossy stone bricks and the chiseled stone bricks are finally craftable. So to do mossy, you do a normal stone brick and a vine. Maybe sometime we'll do cobble and a vine to get mossy cobble. Hint, hint, developers, maybe we'll get that. And if you want the chiseled, just do a half slab of stone bricks stacked like so. The chiseled you can only get in jungle temples previously, so that's really cool. Now people won't tear up strongholds and temples and stuff for those. Unfortunately, along with mossy cobble, the stone brick, the cracked stone brick, is mad because it cannot be crafted still. Maybe we could like jump off a slime block and land on a stone brick to crack it. Or like if a creeper or TNT blew up, it'll have a chance to crack the stone brick. That would be cool. Anyways, so that's the new recipes there. Before we get into the crazy villager trading and enchantment that I gotta cover, we gonna take a quick look here with some food. The carrot used to heal four of your food shanks, and the baked potato used to do six. The carrot now does three, the baked potato now does five. They kind of balanced it a little bit. I think that people were carrying stacks of carrots around and they wanted to balance the food. So anyways, let's get on to villager trading. Now the villagers, their offers are now less random and they're pretty much more useful on the whole. The existing villagers will not be affected, so grab some of those doors now that you can stack them, put them all around your base, make some baby villagers, and get to loving them so they will grow up and trade with you. So trading is now revamped, and you can see all these guys, these are all the different professions. There's not just the five anymore. Some of them look very similar, but maybe they'll get skins in the future. So this is the librarian and the cleric. These guys are nice. They'll buy your enchanted books and stacks. They can offer different enchantments. The cleric's really cool. Get rid of all your rotten flesh, guys. If you've been saving it up till now, you can now get a ton of emeralds. You can sell gold. Just like in the commercials, you can sell ender pearls. You can buy redstone. You can buy lapis. This is very important. Remember lapis. It actually has a use now, other than dying. So you can do a lot of stuff with these guys and earn emeralds very easily. So here are the other professions. There is the butcher. This guy will buy your meat, and I can actually show some of the other stuff here with him. If I sell him some meat, I want to show you this. He will lock out his trade. You probably know how this works a little bit, but it's changed a little bit. So here we go. The trading, it says, a little thing in the GUI now says, trade something else to unlock, and then we'll exit. He'll get the little stinky puffs here in a second, and he'll unlock more trades. So they start with 2 to 4 trades, and now he has unlocked more trades for us. So now I can buy some more food and stuff. So some of the other guys, we got the leather worker, the armorer, the toolsmith, weaponsmith, farmer, fletcher, fisherman, and shepherd. And you, probably noticed, they all have their name up here, which is pretty cool. Some of these guys have really good trades to offer. They'll give you different stuff. You can actually get like arrows from the Fletcher. They're not too expensive, especially if you're earning a lot of money by trading like wheat and carrots and potatoes and stuff that's real common to the farmer. You can get a ton of emeralds, stock up on what you need. You can get fishing enchantments and different stuff from this guy. The Fletcher even gives you this nice gravel conversion to flint. It's actually not as much of a ripoff as it was in the past. So Jeb has spent the time to make these trades more useful and more balanced, and I am very happy for it. So we might still get some tweaks in the future, but that's the trades right now. It's the first time since like 1.3 they've been changed, so very happy with that. Now the enchantment system, this is a big deal as well. Before we get into that, I want to show you this here. So this furnace, let me grab a stick off the side. Previously, if you put material in a furnace and you ran out of material, say you did this and it burned out real quick, you would lose whatever you burned, but now it actually keeps track of how much it is smelted. And if I throw another stick in here, it will finish. So now if you're smelting stuff, you don't have to like calculate exactly how much you're going to smelt and stuff. You can just easily do that. Leave your furnace, the food will stay partially cooked or the ore smelted and all that stuff. So let's get into enchanting. This is a huge change. I'm going to grab all my gear out of here. I'll throw those in there. So I got a bunch of equipment pre-prepared like a cooking show here, and we're going to plop that down. So I mentioned lapis. You need lapis now to do enchantments. We're in survival now, so I can show you how this actually works. So you'll notice this is a little different. Let's pop our sword in there, and there's a spot here for lapis. And this number on the right, this is the level requirement. This is how high your level needs to be in order to enchant. Now the one on the left, you can see this is how many levels you're going to spend. So you only spend 3 levels max to enchant something, which is awesome. And you use 1, 2, and 3 pieces of lapis lazuli as you do it. So it's pretty cheap. Now, on the little tooltip here, you can see the top enchantment, knockback 2, sharpness 2, bane of arthropods. That is the guaranteed enchantment. You will at least get that. Now let's try this here. So I got my knockback 2, but I also got bane of arthropods 4. Not that great, but still not too bad. If I was going to enchant my diamond chest piece, so this is interesting. Every piece of equipment will be locked into enchantment. So this will be unbreaking, projectile protection, blast protection. Say I don't want any of those. I need to enchant something else real quick. Like I'll just enchant this bow real quick and get that out of here. And then if I put this back in, this is projectile protection, fire protection, thorns. It's all different now. So if you want to get a new set of enchantment possibilities, you got to enchant something else first. That's just how it works. Levels are a bit harder to earn now to get to 30. They take a bit more to earn, but also you get experience from trading now. If you notice, you probably heard that little jingle when I was trading, so it's a little easier to get experience in different ways, but it is harder to level up over just to balance it out. You can get level 5 enchantments through here if you're lucky. You don't need to have a book for all of them, which is pretty cool, and so you don't have to find them in the world as much. But yeah, it's a bit of an overhaul. I think it's cheaper just in general, so it's probably going to work out better for most people. Like the villager trading, they wanted to make it more useful for the common player to actually use it, and I think that's going to encourage, like trading, more people to actually do it. Let me grab some of this stuff here, and I'll show you how the anvil is a lot different now as well. Repairing has changed a bit. So if I wanted to repair something in the past, I would throw it in here, maybe throw a diamond in, and sometimes it would get insane, but now, one level, look, just a single level, and if I wanted to rename it, Diamond Sword, it only adds one level to rename things, so things are way cheaper now. Say I wanted to repair this crazy enchanted sword, sharpness 5, knockback, all that stuff, it only costs 5 levels, so it's very cheap to enchant and repair stuff now. I like that. It's a lot easier than it was in the past. If you repaired something and maybe renamed it, every time you rename it, it's going to add another level, but it's still pretty cheap. So this makes it, even if you had a crazy sword decked out with like every enchantment possible, it would still only cost a handful of levels to repair, typically 2 to 5 levels or so to repair stuff. So it is a lot nicer than it was in the past. Very good. Now, I want to go into some of these really cool commands. I mentioned one of them in the past at the beginning here, and I'll get into that in a sec. It's probably the most exciting for people, but check these guys out. So we have this new thing. It's called at E. That is entities. So if you know some of these other things in commands, there's at A, all players, at P, nearest player. At E will target entities like chickens and cats and a bunch of other stuff. That cat is getting stuck like a jello mold. So now that I can do this, I can use commands on entities. So I'm going to teleport these chicken up in the air. They're going to float down and just slowly go. I think that one escaped. Uh-oh. He got lucky. I've got another one over here with these cats. So you can do like a radius. You can type in what type of entity you want to teleport. And I'm just going to pop these cats up in the air. Hopefully they will land in slime. Come on, guys. Oh, a couple of them did. There they go. And they're bouncing around. That one escaped. So yeah, you can teleport stuff. You can do crazy things like I'm just going to sick this zombie on this villager. And as soon as he gets in that door, he's just going to maul him, right? Nope. He's going in the sky. He's dead. So yeah, you can mess with entities now. There's also the slash kill command. If you remember that, in the past, if you were to type slash kill, you would kill yourself. But now it actually has a use. So you can do entities. If you do slash kill and you do at E, that is every entity on the server, including every villager, every player. Do not let anyone you don't trust use commands, because they can kill everybody. But I'm using a parameter to kill every zombie in 100 blocks. So if I put some zombies down here, they're going to go for the villagers, but I killed them, so they could not feast on the flesh of the innocent. If you add an exclamation point here, it will target everything except that. So that's how you do little parameters like that. And you want to do a radius so you don't kill everything if you're going to kill things. So some of the other commands here, block data. This allows you to edit a tile entity's data, such as a chest. You can see this chest is empty. If I was to push this button, we're going to get a new item, 7 of them actually, in slot 5 here. So I put 7 diamond swords. You can stack them using this. You can't normally stack them. I can't restack them now. But yeah, you can put stuff in chests that are already sitting there using that. And this is the really exciting one that I like. So this chest is locked. I can't open it. You can hear the door slamming sound. I can't get in there. Well, it's because it is locked and it has a key that I need. I just happen to have the skeleton key here in my inventory. It is like a cooking show. So here we go. This is prepared. If I click this, we can unlock this magical chest of wonders. But if I try anything else, I cannot open it. It does not use the key up when you open it. So this is mainly for adventure maps. You basically set up a chest here using block data, and you can do lock, and then you name the key. It doesn't have to be a bone or anything. It's anything named skeleton key. The way I see this, though, it's intended for adventure maps, but I think servers are probably going to implement something like this. You name a key, you can give it, it's basically a password for you. You have an item named something, and then only you can use it to unlock blocks, or unlock chests and things, and prevent forest fires. So only you can do that, because it would just like be like a password that no one else knows. And if you want to reset it on that, you just put in this thing with lock and you do blank and it will reset it so that I can open it regardless of whether I have the key in my hand or you can lock it again. So yeah, I think this is very promising for servers and different stuff. You can use these to lock chests and hopefully that gets implemented into like the way it works, gets like worked into more plugins and different stuff. I'm sure there's stuff that does similar things, but I like where this is headed. So hopefully it keeps going that way. Adventure mode, I mentioned that was overhauled. I'm going to go into adventure mode. Now, while I'm in adventure mode, I cannot break any blocks. I cannot place any blocks. I can't do anything that I would normally be able to do. I can open this, but I can't interact with any of this stuff. I don't think I can even break grass or flowers as I normally would in adventure mode right now. So adventure mode's kind of been reverted back to its old ways where you can't do anything unless you have the tools. But they added that later. So now this is a little weird, but you'll see if I get a tool, so I can give myself a diamond shovel, and if I use the can destroy tag, this will be able to destroy sand, grass, stone, and diamond ore. So the way this is going to work on adventure maps, by default, you can't do anything, breaking, placing, any of that. But if a person sets up an adventure map with the right tools, I can break these certain blocks. And I can chew into stone, it'll take a while. I can even break diamond ore with this thing. But I cannot break gravel, I can't break a door, because it's not on the tool. You can see it in the tooltip here. What I can break, it doesn't even show you the outline when you hover over something, you might notice here. So that's kind of funny. It just shows you what you can and can't break. You can see the outline around this, but you don't see it there. Anyways, that's just how adventure mode works now. If they added an option that let us place blocks if we wanted to, that would be perfect. But right now, I can see this giving map makers a lot more freedom in what they can do. They don't have to worry about people breaking through stuff in the map or using tools. You know, they can kind of dictate how the map is supposed to flow. So it's promising. It screws up my hardcore adventure world if you've been watching that series. But anyways, it's promising. I like where it's going. If they add more to it, just like the locks, I think it can be really good. So speaking of locks, you might notice this on your menu. It is a difficulty lock. If I click this, it will say, are you sure you want to lock the difficulty of this world? Once you click yes, you cannot change this difficulty from whatever it is. This is to prevent people from having a world set to hard and then switching their difficulty to peaceful and then logging into the world and screwing things up because you were in the wrong difficulty. You will lock in your world difficulty, and then whenever you lock in, you don't have to worry about that. I wish they would add something like a warning when you would log into worlds that would say, hey, this is a 1.6 world, you're in 1.7, are you sure you want to go in here? That type of thing. Because I've logged into so many worlds with the wrong version of the game and screwed them up with mods and different stuff, and if they added something like that, that would be great. So there's another hint to the developers. So look at these pictures here, please. This is the swamp tree. These are now kind of weird. They're so bright. And I think it might be a glitch in like the way the foliage is generated, because look at this jungle tree. It's like as bright as it would be in the jungle when it's in the swamp biome. But I don't know if that was intended. I know they were sprucing up the swamp to make it a bit brighter. I didn't know they were going to go this far, but we'll see. That could just be a glitch, but it's kind of strange. If you hit F3 now, you'll notice next to the east, north, west indicator, it says north towards negative Z, east towards positive X. This just kind of helps you reorient yourself so you don't have to walk around looking where the coordinates are changing. You'll know exactly which direction you're headed very easily. So there's a big thing, the UUID. This is the unique user ID. And if anyone has ever wanted to change their Minecraft username, this is important. This is going to allow us to change our username. So if I hit this command, this will tell me every entity on the server. So let's pop that. Look at all these. Sheep, pig, cow, chicken, everything, bat, creeper. I can't even see these guys. They're underground. And even little things like items on the ground. And if I hit F3 plus H, this is the thing that normally tells you the data value of items. Like you can see the item number of shovels and you can see the durability, all that stuff. If I have that on and I select an entity's name, including my own, if I could find myself in here, you will see this long string of numbers. It looks like a serial number underneath there. That is the UUID. So basically, in the future, when we can change our Minecraft ID names or usernames, whatever our display name is, so if I wanted to be just like Swimming Bird instead of Swimming Board 941, hopefully we'll be able to do that. That's the plan, they said. But this ID number is going to make it so that servers know who you are. It's almost like, you know how you have a Steam account and you can change your Steam display name to whatever you want, but you still have that name linked, the main name linked to your account. That's kind of how it's going to be, I believe. So we'll have to see more about that in the future, but Mojang has promised that that is coming. Teleporting. A little strange here. It's supposed to be smoother than it is. I tried to trick you guys by building this little house, and then we walk in, and you can see I kind of jump up a little bit. But I was supposed to trick you, and then we come out, and you're like, oh, we're in a different location. But you could see it was not as smooth as it's supposed to be. If you're in the same chunk, it's supposed to be even smoother. But I didn't really know. It still looks like there's a bit of like a jump when you go. It's definitely really fast to teleport now, but it's not quite as smooth as I've seen other people do it. I think it's got some work on it, but there's been a lot of performance enhancing and supposedly work towards the mod API and stuff going on. The world threading that Dinnerbone mentioned to make worlds not lag each other when you're playing in the Nether and your friends are in the overworld sort of thing, that is still being worked on. We haven't seen that yet, but that's coming. So some of the bugs they fixed. You guys remember I mentioned the chicken jockey thing where chicken jockeys were spawning. They were dropping eggs everywhere like mad. Zombies were picking the eggs up and then the zombies don't despawn and they lag the server. Well, that has been fixed. I tested this out. A chicken will now despawn when its baby zombie despawns. So now you don't have to worry about the chicken zombies anymore. They're still out there to kill you. Don't forget that, but they won't leave eggs everywhere and screw up your server with lag. Villagers ignoring damage value on items and item tags and stuff, that has been fixed. There was a weird thing where all the mobs had a strange tendency to go northwest. And you might have noticed that in some of my old snapshots, the horses would like walk towards the northwest. And I was like, what are you doing, buddy? Where are you going? Well, it was some weird thing in the code where they all wanted to walk towards that way, but that has been fixed as well. So they will now walk wherever they want to go. They don't have to heed that invisible master. And last, zombies killing villagers on hard difficulty will always turn them into zombie villagers. There's no doubt about that, instead of actually just killing them. So those are the bug fixes. One last crazy thing. Jeb already said this has been fixed, but I want to show you guys real quick. I'm going to grab this water pail. Thank you for watching. Water has this weird bug. Look at this. It will flow everywhere and grief everything. It doesn't just flow down. It just spreads out like crazy. Look at that. That is insane. Thanks for watching, guys. Lava does the same. Leave a like if you enjoy this. And thank you guys for watching the snapshot and sticking with me through all of these updates and all this madness. I don't mention this very often, but do subscribe if you do like these Minecraft videos and you like my other stuff too. I play a lot of other games as well. And I appreciate you guys watching. Thank you once again for sticking with me and choosing my snapshot update to get you your Minecraft news. So I will see you guys next time for more of that. Goodbye.